Sometimes the easiest way to get ahead for the work week is to cook on Sundays. I mean, there's got to be one day when you're not overwhelmed, when it's not rush, rush, rush. So here's the plan. Eat these hearty meals on Sunday and then reheat or reuse them in many different ways during the week.
Nothing says Sunday like roast chicken, and this one's a family favorite. It's stuffed with zucchini and cheese, which makes the meat incredibly moist. Plus, it tastes just as good later in the week when you're pressed for time. Then, an all-time classic, my red wine braised brisket with flying discs. Fancy-shaped matzo balls braised in gravy. I learned it from my mother-in-law, and I'm passing it on to you.
The bonus of Sunday cook-ahead meals? Well, they tend to be comfort food, and that's exactly what you need on Sunday night before the start of the next dreaded work week. Funding provided by
Subaru builds vehicles like the versatile Subaru Forester with symmetrical all-wheel drive and plenty of cargo room. A recipe made for whatever the day brings. Subaru, a proud sponsor of Sara's Weeknight Meals.
Family owned and Indiana grown, Maple Leaf Farms is a proud sponsor of Sara's Weeknight Meals. Providing a variety of duck products for home kitchens, Maple Leaf Farms Duck helps inspire culinary adventures everywhere. Maple Leaf Farms.
Ezra's Feta Cheese, family made for more than a century.
I'm Sara Moulton. Welcome to Sara's Weeknight Meals. You know, no matter how you roast a chicken, it always comes out dry. Well, I have a little trick that I'm going to show you right now. You make a really moist stuffing. Mine has zucchini and cheese, and you put it under the skin. That really keeps the meat very juicy. So we're starting with some fresh breadcrumbs here, and it's so easy to make your own. If you don't have bread around the house that you need to get rid of, you might keep some in the freezer just for this purpose. Or if you have some leftover bread, go ahead and make breadcrumbs and then freeze it as crumbs. All you do is just pulse it in either a blender or a food processor. So one slice of bread, you know, a normal size slice, is about a half a cup of crumbs. You could get it finer than this. It depends on what kind of crumbs you started with. Now we're going to use the food processor again to grate our zucchini. I love grating vegetables on the food processor because they just take no time at all. I do it oftentimes on a weeknight because after you've grated them, they take 3 minutes to saute in a pan all by their happy little selves. I'm going to take off the top and the bottom. And it's just one lone little zucchini, about 6 ounces is what we need. I highly recommend doing this on a day that you've had a bad time at the office. It's very cathartic. Okay. Now what we're gonna do with zucchini, because it's so wet, is we're gonna drain it, actually put it in a strainer and add some salt. And just a little bit of salt is gonna pull out all this liquid, so it will be less watery and will also concentrate the flavor. Now it's very interesting, my son doesn't really like zucchini. He's not really a big vegetable fan to begin with, but he just loves this dish. Let me get my onions on, a little bit of olive oil. This is a Mediterranean recipe. And in goes our onion. This is such an amazing recipe in terms of the moistness of the chicken meat that I plan someday to do it at Thanksgiving. Next, I'm gonna do a little bit of garlic. And just whack it to get the skin off. And then we'll mince away with a tiny bit of salt. Okay, you know, the finer you get the garlic, the more flavor you're gonna get out of it. Fresh thyme, what a difference, and you can really find it everywhere. You know, I of course have some in my garden, but most supermarkets even carry it. We want about a teaspoon. And then it's zucchini time. You'll see how much liquid it's given off. there's already quite a bit in the bottom of the bowl, but it's gonna give off so much more. I'm gonna squeeze it right here and then throw it into the saute pan. Now for the cheese part. If you hadn't noticed already, I'm a huge cheese lover. I just like it. I try not to overdo it, you know, just a little bit is good. Now, so we're gonna be using some grated Parmigiano Reggiano. When you wanna know you're getting the real McCoy, the way you know that you're getting the real McCoy is to check the rind. Real Parmigiano Reggiano should have something written on the rind. Some part of the words of Parmigiano Reggiano should be there, just like you see here. And the real McCoy, it makes such a difference, and a little goes a long way. We grated 1.5 ounces here, Parmigiano Reggiano. So I'm just gonna add it. Whole milk ricotta, we only need 1/4 cup. You could use a lower fat ricotta if you wanted to. Not a no fat, I don't know if they make no fat. I think no fat mostly equals no flavor. In we go. So we're building, this is all our stuffing. And last but not least, we're gonna add our zucchini mixture. And the cheeses in there are gonna cool it down enough, so hopefully we can right away stuff the chicken. You don't want this to be too hot. We don't really wanna put hot stuffing right away under the skin. We want it to slowly heat up. Stir this up, a little bit of pepper, and some salt. I've made this, believe it or not, you're probably thinking, oh, you've got all that cheese in there. What do you need salt for? I've made this and forgotten that extra little bit of salt, and it's been just a tad bland. Okay, now I'm gonna loosen the skin on the chicken. This is a little bit, well, it requires patience. We've got a sweet little 3.5 pound chicken, and we've already loosened the skin a little bit. Where you wanna loosen the skin is here, and you just gently put your fingers in and you go all the way down on the chicken breast, which is the part that dries out the most. And then bring your finger also around the thigh and the leg. Try not to rip it. If you do, don't worry. I've actually made this and the whole thing split apart. And the skin, I mean, after the first round of cooking. And at that point, I just put foil over it and it was still delicious. And the meat was still so moist. So I'm gonna just take a little mound in here. And then you just keep moving it back, pressing it back. We're gonna start this in a 450 degree oven for the first 10 minutes. Then we're gonna turn it down to 375 and give it another 20 minutes. At that point, you should take the chicken out, put it on the counter, and cover it with foil. Because of the cheese in there, the skin gets very, very brown. So we'll cover it with foil, pop it back in the 375 degree oven, and give it another 30, 35 minutes, or until it registers 165 on an instant read thermometer. All right, I'm gonna go hose down. I got all this chicken on me. Wow. Oof. We have to wait 10 minutes though. I know you want to dive right in, but it's going to be dry if we carve it right away because all the juices will come streaming out. They need to redistribute. So I'm going to go tidy up while I let it rest. All right, 10 minutes later, we can plate. So the easiest way to move it is to get something. If you don't have a nice long fork like this, you could use the handle of a wooden spoon and just stick it in the cavity and you'll be able to move the sweet little chicken. And I've got some roasted vegetables. I've got some potatoes, Yukon Gold, and some summer squash. Any roasted vegetables would be nice. You could throw them in while the chicken is cooking. My family absolutely loves this recipe, and I hope yours does too. Hi, I'm Sara Moulton. Welcome to Sara's Weeknight Meals. Today is all about cooking ahead, and what better candidate for that than brisket. And boy, do I have a special recipe for you. It's my mother-in-law's via my husband's great aunt Rivka. Was her recipe. It's red wine, braised brisket with flying discs. And you might be wondering, what the heck is a flying disc? Here, let me get this under here. Well, a flying disc, I sort of hate to tell you because it's sort of more fun to surprise you at the end. I just had to get underneath it. Whoa! Yeah, this is a big piece of meat here. A flying disc is actually a matzo ball that's been flattened and it gets braised in gravy. Boom, I said it. It's wonderful. So we start by braising our brisket. We're using the flat cut, about a 4 to 5 pound piece. We seasoned it first. We had a couple tablespoons of oil in there. We browned it. I'm gonna put this onion in and add another one. Now, I've looked at so many brisket recipes, and the famous one that many people do involves a package of dry soup mix. I know it comes out for many people just wonderfully, but I'd rather deal with the real McCoy. So we're gonna put two large onions in there to begin with. And these are very key to the whole recipe, gives it great depth of flavor and sort of a viscosity that we love. So very quickly, this is gonna go in. So let me get this guy in there. Let me just give them a stir. And a tiny pinch of salt. I like to season as I go. And a little bit of pepper. So we're gonna put the lid on and give them 15 minutes covered. Stir every so often. And then 15 minutes uncovered until they are really caramelized and reduced. So while that's cooking, I'm gonna get my garlic minced. Now, another very key part, I think, of excellent brisket is garlic. I just think it gives it wonderful, I don't know, je ne sais quoi. There we go. We need about 3 tablespoons. Now, let me just open up my tomato paste. All of these things have great depth of flavor. It's like, you know, they talk about umami, the fifth taste, and they provide that depth of flavor that just makes the whole dish taste better. Okay, so I've got that all ready to go while my onions keep cooking. We're gonna pause for a second and talk about brisket. I have some brisket samples that I wanna show you. This is a flat cut. This is the leaner of the two choices. This is a point cut, and this is altogether a fattier piece, more fat running through it, more fat on top. If you're going for pure flavor and you don't care about fat, take this piece, the point cut. If you want a leaner roast, take the flat cut. And just trim a little bit of the fat off, but you need the fat. And what all that fat cooking in there with the meat does for 5 hours is provide flavor. You can always skim it off afterwards, and we're gonna do that. Okay, I'm gonna go take the lid off of my onions, give them a stir, and give them another 15 minutes. These look really perfect, I have to say. That's what you want. You don't need a dehydrated soup mix. You need real onions cooked down like this. Yay. Okay, in goes our garlic. We're gonna put in a teaspoon of thyme. And bay leaf, we're gonna put 2 in. And about a 1/4 cup of tomato paste. We're just gonna stir that all up. And what we're doing is getting the raw taste out of the tomato paste. And finally, 3 cups of red wine that we're gonna reduce down to 1 by boiling it. All right, that looks pretty good. That's reduced down the way I need it to. So I'm going to add the chicken broth. I've got 1 quart here of chicken broth. You could use beef broth. When Aunt Rivka first made this, I think she probably did her own homemade chicken broth. She probably wouldn't have done beef broth, so that's why. I'm gonna put the brisket back in. Yes, you want it to be just about submerged. I've got a little bit of liquid here from the resting meat. Don't ever want to waste that. That's liquid gold. And now I'm going to cover it. I have a piece of parchment. I had to trace the lid to get exactly the right size. The reason we're doing this is while this is in the oven, you really want none of the liquid to escape. And by putting the parchment right on top of the meat, it just all stays in there. We're preserving all the moisture. We're not going to lose any. So now I'm going to pop this in the oven. The 300 degree oven. Okay. Whew. Okay. So 5 to 6 hours later, it should be ready, but you want to check it. Let's see. Oh, that smells so good. That makes me happy. Take off the parchment. So I'm going to transfer the brisket and the liquid to a shallow casserole and chill it overnight. And the reason I like to do this is that's the easiest way to remove the fat, because overnight it will congeal, it will get hard, and then I can just scoop it off. But while this is cooling off, I'm going to go down and make my discs. Okay, I've got all my ingredients laid out here. We're going to start with the eggs, 4 eggs. Anytime a recipe says 4 eggs, they generally mean large. Now, I make matzo balls at Passover and for special occasions. My son loves them. Let me add 1/4 cup of chicken broth to it, and then I'll beat them up. Okay, so there goes our eggs. Now we're gonna add a whole cup of matzo meal. You can find it in the supermarket, I think almost all year long. 2 tablespoons of vegetable oil, and then 3/4 teaspoon of salt, kosher salt. And that is the batter. It's not complicated. It's usually right on the, similar proportions are right on the back of the package. It's no different, my Aunt Rivka's flying disc, than matzo balls. And it seems very wet after you mix it up, or sort of mushy. But after it sets up for an hour in the fridge, it's really dense and very easy to shape. Okay, that's looking good. Into the fridge. All right, so you're gonna see what they look like after after it's chilled for an hour. It's really, really hard stuff. Okay, wet hands. I'm still gonna get all matzo balled up, but we scoop, heaping scoop, and then shape it into a nice little disc. And you just keep going. They puff up like crazy when you cook them. I'm gonna get smart and do a whole bunch and then shape them. This would be a fun thing to do with kids. You know, it's like shaping little Play-Doh, I think they would probably like that. It's rather soothing activity. So now I'm gonna add them to the water. We're gonna add salt. You want the water to be salted for sure. Just slide them in. And they take about 30 minutes, tightly covered, for them to cook properly. You can make them a day ahead of time, just like you're making the brisket a day ahead of time. There's nothing wrong with that. They'll be just fine. There we go. So tight lid, 30 minutes. I'm going to wash my hands, go get the mail, clean up, and then see how they're doing. Oh, hey, Greg.
Hi.
All right, let me see how those matzo balls are doing. Or should I say flying discs? Oh, they're perfect. You see how puffy they get? All right, I'm just gonna put them in here. They're gonna go pretty soon. They're gonna be combined with the sauce and the brisket. Now, you could cook them up to this point, as I mentioned before, and just chill them overnight, and that would be perfectly fine. Discs are ready. Let me grab my brisket. It's been chilling overnight so that fat congealed on the top, but this way we can get off that fat. Here we go. And you could save it to cook with. I mean, keep in mind that it's beef fat and it's saturated, but it has tons of flavor. It'd be a wonderful thing to cook potatoes in. See how easily that comes up? Now I'm gonna leave all of the onions. I'm just gonna take the bay leaves out. brisket comes out, and all of this great stuff goes right into the pan. Here we go. Alrighty then. Just rinse off. Now, the next thing I'm about to do, I learned from my brother-in-law, and he makes an amazing brisket. So I said, Ricky, what is it that you do that's so wonderful? He said, I slice it before I finally serve it. He'd get to the point that I'm at right now. This is, thank you, Ricky. He says, and then I put the brisket right back into the liquid, and I heat it in the liquid for 30 minutes. And that completely re-energizes the brisket, makes it moist, gets that gravy all over the place, and just makes it the best brisket on the planet. The discs are now gonna go in the bottom of the pan, okay? Now all of the brisket is gonna go right on top of the discs, and I have these, I don't know if you have a shovel like this at home. If I wasn't using this, I would use my giant cake lifter, favorite tools we have. So the discs go on the bottom because we want them to absorb some of the gravy. This all goes in. Tuck it in so it gets nicely sort of coated with sauce. And then I'm gonna top this with a piece of parchment like we did before because we don't wanna lose any liquid. And this will keep it all in. I'm bringing it up to a boil right now because there's no point putting cold liquid and cold meat in the oven. You might as well at least have the liquid up to the boil. And then as soon as it does, I'll hear it in just a minute. I'm just gonna wash off. Then we'll pop it in a 350 degree oven for about 30 minutes or until it's completely heated through. And then we'll be good to go to serve it. Okay. While that's heating up, I want to talk to you about the sauce that you could serve with the brisket. Now let me start by saying, let me just wipe this down with a paper towel, that you wouldn't serve this sauce if this was a kosher meal, because one of the rules about kosher eating is you do not mix dairy and meat. If you're not kosher, oops, it's okay to make this sauce. All right, so we're gonna use bottled horseradish. It's a horseradish sour cream sauce, I should have said that. But you could use fresh horseradish. This is what it looks like when it's cut. I rinse it, I peel it, and then you just grate it on a grater. But what I put into my sauce was the bottled, some sour cream, some chives, some white vinegar, and some lemon juice, salt and pepper. And here's my finished sauce. Okay, I'm gonna go check my brisket and see how we're doing. Right, here we go. Time to serve the dish. Lovely. So we want to make sure that you get a little bit of everything on the plate. The meat's probably going to fall apart because it's so wonderfully moist. Look at that. There's our flying discs. Oop. That's what you want though. You want it falling apart. Nice. I'm going to just put a little chopped chives on top. Chopped parsley would be nice too because it just sort of perks it up. It's a nice way to go. Okay, it's time to enjoy my delicious make-ahead red wine braised brisket. And I'm serving this with some broccoli rabe, sauteed with some garlic chips. I love broccoli rabe, that bitter taste. We're serving this with just a nice full-bodied red wine, because that would be perfect with this. So there you go, you know, cooking ahead is not such a bad idea. It really helps you to get dinner on the table during the work week. The food tastes better, and think about how many meals I'm gonna get out of this. This is a budget saver. This is a good one. I'm Sara Moulton, thanks for joining me, and I'll see you next time on Sara's Weeknight Meals.
S-
Sara's Weeknight Meals continues online. For recipes, helpful tips, messages, and lots more, visit us on the web at saramoulton.com/weeknightmeals.
Funding provided by
Subaru builds vehicles like the versatile Subaru Forester with symmetrical all-wheel drive and plenty of cargo room. A recipe made for whatever the day brings. Subaru, a proud sponsor of Sara's Weeknight Meals.
Family owned and Indiana grown, Maple Leaf Farms is a proud sponsor of Sara's Weeknight Meals. Providing a variety of duck products for home kitchens, Maple Leaf Farms Duck helps inspire culinary adventures everywhere. Maple Leaf Farms.
Ezra's Feta Cheese, family made for more than a century.